21 lessons for the 21st century. Immigration. From racism to culturalism. A century ago, Europeans took it for granted that some races, most notably the white race, were inherently superior to others. After 1945, such views increasingly became anathema. Racism was seen not only as morally abysmal, but also scientifically bankrupt. Ripe scientists, and in particular geneticists, have produced very strong scientific evidence that the biological differences between European, African, Chinese, and Native Americans are negligible. At the same time, however, anthropologists, sociologists, historians, behavioral economists, and even brain scientists have accumulated a wealth of data of existence of significant differences between human cultures. After all, if all human cultures were essentially the same, why would we even need anthropologists and historians? Why invest resources in studying trivial differences? At the very least, we should stop financing all those expensive field excursions to the South Pacific and the Kalahari Desert, and be content with studying people in Oxford or Boston. In cultural differences are insignificant, then whatever we discover about Harvard undergraduate should be true of Kalahari hunter-gatherers too. Upon reflection, most people consider the existence of at least some significant differences between human culture, in things ranging from sexual moral to political habit. How then should we treat these differences? Cultural relativists argue that differences doesn't imply hierarchy, and we should never prefer one culture over another. Humans may think and behave in various ways, but we should celebrate this diversity and give equal value to all beliefs and practices. Unfortunately, such broad-minded attitude cannot stand the test of reality. Human diversity may be great when it comes to cuisine and poetry, but few would see witch burning, infanticide, or slavery as fascinating human idiosyncrasy that should be protected against the encroachment of global capitalism and coca colonialism. Well, consider the way different cultures relate to strangers, immigrants, and refugees. Not all cultures are characterized by exactly the same level of acceptance. German culture in the early 21st century is most tolerant of strangers and more welcoming of immigrants than Saudi culture. It's far easier for a Muslim to immigrate to Germany than it's for a Christian to immigrate to Saudi Arabia. Indeed, it's probably easier for even a Muslim refugee from Syria to immigrate to Germany than to Saudi Arabia. And since 2011, Germany has taken many more Syrian refugees than has Saudi Arabia. Similarly, the weight of evidence suggests that the culture of California in the early 21st century is more immigrant-friendly than the culture of Japan. Therefore, if you think it's good to tolerate stranger and welcome immigrant, shouldn't you also think that, at least in this regard, German culture is superior to Saudi culture, and Californian culture is better than Japanese culture. Moreover, even when two cultural norms are equally valid in theory, the practical concept of immigration might still be justified to judge the host culture as better. Norm and value that are appropriate in one culture just don't work well under different circumstances. Let's look closely at a concrete example in order not to fall prey to well-established prejudice. Let's imagine two financial countries, Cordia and Warmland. The two countries have many cultural differences, among which is their attitude to human relationship and interpersonal conflict. Cordians are educated from infancy that if you get into conflict with somebody at school, at work, or even in your family, the best thing to do is to repress it. You should avoid shouting, expressing rage, and confronting the other person. Angry outbursts just make things worse. It's better to work with your own feeling while allowing things to cool down. In the meantime, limit your contact with the person in question, and if contact is unavoidable, be terse but polite and avoid sensitive issues. Homelanders, by contrast, they're educated from infancy to externalize conflict. If you find yourself in conflict, they believe, don't let it simmer and don't repress anything. Use the first opportunity you get to vent your emotion openly. It's okay to get angry, to shout, and to tell the other person exactly how you feel. This is the one way to work things through together. In the honest and direct way, one way of shouting can resolve a conflict that might otherwise pass for years. And though head-on confrontation is never pleasant, you will all feel much better afterward. Both these methods have their pros and cons, and it's hard to say that one is always better than the other. What might happen, though, when a Warmlander immigrate to Cordia and get a job in the Cordian firm? Whenever a conflict arises with a coworker, the Warmlander begin on the table and yell at the top of voice, expecting that this will focus attention on the problem and help to resolve it quickly. Several years later, a senior position falls vacant. Though the Warmlander has all the necessary qualifications, the boss prefer to give the promotion to Cordian employee. When asked about it, she explained, "Yes, the Warmlander has many talents, but he also has a serious problem with human relations. He's hot-tempered, creates unnecessary tension around him, and disturbs our corporate culture." The same fate befall other Warmlander immigrate to Cordia. Most of them remain in junior position or fail to find any job at all. Because the major presuppose that if they are Warmlander, they'll probably be hot-tempered and problematic employees. Since the Homelander never reach senior position, it's difficult for them to change the Cordian corporate culture. Much the same thing happened to Cordian to immigrate to Homeland. The Cordian starting to work in Homelander firm quickly acquired a reputation for a snap or a cold pitch and make a few, if any, friends. People think that he's insincere or that he lacks basic human relation skill. He never advanced to senior position and he therefore never get the opportunity to change the corporate culture. Homeland managers conclude that most Cordians are unfriendly or shy. and prefer not to hire them to position that require contact with the customer to close your cooperation with other employees. Both of these cases may seem to smack of racism, but in fact, they are not racist. They are culturalist. People continue to conduct a heretic struggle against the traditional racism without noting that the battleground too has shifted. Traditional racism is waning, but the world is now full of cultures.